Hello. So today we're going to tackle floating point numbers. This is the topic that a lot of students struggle with in this course. So make sure you allocate enough time to watch all the videos, do all the readings, and work through the lab. This is consistently one of the topics that students find to be challenging in this course. So we'll first talk about a little bit of the review from last time. We did a little short teaser about this. We'll talk about the nitty-gritty details about how floating point works. We'll talk about a lot of the issues with floating point, and then we'll look at some of the trade-offs associated with the different floating point formats. And finally, we'll wrap up by talking about conversions and doing a few of them manually. So we talked a little bit last time about how we can extend the sort of base two positional binary integers to store fractions simply by adding more digits after the fractional point. And so you'd have the normal bits on the left side that represent the whole numbers, the integers, and then you have the fractional part that is to the right of the point. And those represent negative powers of 2, just like the digits on the left represent positive powers of 2. This is the same way that it works in decimal, remember. They're just powers of 2 instead of powers of 10. Also note at this point that it's not quite correct to call this a decimal point anymore, right? It's a binary point. And so we're going to shy away from using the word decimal to mean fraction in this course. So and colloquially, a lot of people use the word decimal to refer to a fractional number, but we're going to be reserving the term decimal to mean a base 10 number here. So this is the fractional part of a binary fractional number. So the other problem that we talked about is, so now we have the ability to represent fractional parts in binary. We still have the issue of being able to represent a large dynamic range. So we want to be able to represent very, very tiny fractions as well as enormous numbers. And so it's quite difficult to do that with fixed precision numbers. In other words, the number of bits allocated, for, whole number, the whole number part and the fractional part is fixed. So instead, what we do is a variant on something that hopefully you're already familiar with, which is scientific notation. This is a way in science, in fields like biology and chemistry and physics, to write very large or small numbers conveniently using this notation, where we write it as some number, where usually we have one digit and then the point, and then some number of significant fractional digits. And the actual value is that number times some power of the base, which usually in scientific fields is 10. And this is exactly how floating point representations work in computer systems. We store the exponent and the fractional part separately. So these are all different ways of writing the same number here, just with different exponents, and so we need to store two pieces of information. At least we need to store the fractional part, which is sometimes referred to as a significand, and then we actually need to store the exponent. And so that, roughly speaking, is how floating point representation is going to work.